We worship you again, and Lord, we never stop worshiping you. Just pray that you will come by Holy Spirit. Speak to our hearts and encourage us, Lord, that we just have strength to carry on and to go forward, Lord. I just pray that you would have your way and that your name be lifted up and glorified. We ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Well, I've got a few songs, maybe a bit different the way you sing it, but you have to bear with me. The songs are not always the same when I sing them, but it's a joyful noise. We bring a sacrifice of praise. I sing it quite fast. I don't know how you sing it. We bring a sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring a sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy. We bring a sacrifice of praise. Are the most effective, I should say, is when you feel the least like it. When you feel the least like praying or praising God, that's when it's most effective. Praise Him, praise Him. Let's sing that one.
Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him in the morning, praise Him in the noontime. Praise Him, praise Him when the sun goes down. Love Him in the morning, love Him in the noontime. Love Him when the sun goes down. Worship in the morning, worship in the night.
And it's the Holy Ghost and fire that keeps me alive. It's the Holy Ghost and fire, and it's keeping me alive. It's keeping me alive. It's keeping me alive. It's the Holy Ghost and fire, and it's keeping me alive. Jesus is keeping me alive. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah to the Lamb. And it's all over me, and it's keeping me alive. It's keeping me alive. It's keeping me alive. And it's all over me, and it's keeping me alive. Jesus is keeping me alive. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah to the Lamb. It's all over me, and it's all over me, and it's keeping me alive. It's keeping me alive. It's keeping me alive. It's the only life there is, really. It's the Holy Ghost. Amen. And it keeps you alive. And you know what else it does? It gives you sanity. It gives you sanity. Without the Holy Ghost, people go insane. Amen. Calling sweet sour and sour sweet. And light darkness and cool darkness light. Amen. That's the way it is without it. So, it's good to know that we are the temple of the Holy Ghost. Look, next song says, know ye not, know ye not, ye are the temple. Let's sing that one. Know ye not, ye are the temple. Know ye not, you are the temple. Know ye not, you are the temple. You are the temple of the Holy Ghost. Yes, I know, I am the temple. Yes, I know, I am the temple. Yes, I know, I am the temple. I am the temple of the Holy Ghost. Full of praise, full of power, and full of glory. One more, and then Brother Charlie will come up and sing a song. The next one is, you've got the joy, joy, joy down in my heart. I've got the joy. But you know, just one thought. We just sang, no, you're not, no, you're not. You are the temple. That's a scripture. Bible says you are the temple of the Holy Ghost. Amen. You know, one day Jesus came to the temple, in the natural temple. And guess what? He had to clean it out. He had to clean it out. He turned over tables. He made a weapon. That's how you deal to the devil. It's not against the temple. It's against what shouldn't be in the temple. And if we take the gospel and the truth that way, we don't get offended. We don't get offended. Amen. Amen. I've got the joy. I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Down in my heart. Down in my heart. I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Down in my heart to stay. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart. I've got a peace. I've got that peace that passes understanding down in my heart. Down in my heart. Down in my heart. I've got that peace that passes understanding down in my heart. Down in my heart to stay. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart. And I'm so happy, so very happy. I've got the love of Jesus in my heart. We leave it here. We haven't got the words for that one. Amen. So, Brother Charlie.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
God is good.
Amen.
Amen. He's always good.
Amen.
Jesus, we enthrone you. We proclaim you a king. Standing here in the midst of us, we lift you up with our praise. And as we worship, build your throne. And as we worship, build your throne. And as we worship, build your throne. Come, Lord Jesus, and take your place. Jesus, we enthrone you. We proclaim you a king. Standing here in the midst of us, we lift you up with our praise. And as we worship, build your throne. And as we worship, build your throne. And as we worship, build your throne. Come, Lord Jesus, and take your place. Exalt the Lord our God. Exalt the Lord our God. And worship at his footstool. Worship at his footstool. Holy is is here. Holy is he. Exalt the Lord our God. Exalt the Lord our God. And worship at his footstool. Worship at his footstool. Holy is he. Holy is he.
God bless you.
Well, it was very nice, wasn't it? Praise the Lord. I can't sing like that, but I can make a joyful noise, I'll tell you that much. Amen. Let's sing together, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a taste of glory divine, ear of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior, held it along.
Just to have a couple more, let's sing Higher Ground.
I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day, till praying as I'm onward bound. Higher ground, Lord, lift me up and let me stand
Let's rise above the problems of this world. Let's go higher. Just before we read the word of God, let's sing You Are Beautiful Beyond Description. We sing about the Lord Jesus Christ here. You are beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words. Wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can grasp your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depth of your love? You are beautiful beyond description, majesty enthroned above. I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy, wonderful. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. We stand in awe of you, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I just read one verse first. I've got it in here. In the Bible. I read out of the Bible. How's that? That's a good start. I read from Matthew chapter 4, verse 4. But he answered and said, that's Jesus, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Amen. You may be seated. I've got a few scriptures and a few thoughts. Basically, what I would like to encourage you with is we need all of the Word of God. Amen. Not just part of it, we need all of it. And you know, even more so in these last days, there's a scripture where the Lord says, you know, even the very elect will be deceived if possible, because there's so much going on. Some looks good, some looks obviously wrong, but we need discernment and we need all of the Word of God. So that's my thought this morning, or this afternoon, I better say. And I may as well read that whole story from Matthew 4, from verse 1. It says here, then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward an hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. You see, that's how the devil started. He first attacked the natural flesh. You're hungry, he comes with something natural. If you've got a weakness in the flesh, he attacks you with that, you know. And many people have weaknesses in the flesh, so the devil comes first with that. But Jesus answered him with the Word, because he was the Word. We know John 1 says, at the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So Christ is the Word. So he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. That's what we live by. I mean, we need bread. Of course we need bread. I would not despise bread. I didn't despise church lunch, you know. We need that as well. But here, he was tempting him to perform a miracle. If you are the Son of God, turn these stones into bread so you can eat, you know. You do something to profit yourself. But you know what the Holy Spirit does? The Holy Spirit lives his life for others. Did you know that? That's true. So he tempted him first with the natural. Next thing, he goes and says, then the devil taketh him up into the holy city and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple and saith unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, he shall give the angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Here again, first thing, if you are the Son of God, if you are a Christian, do this. If you are a Christian, why are you sick? Why are you not healed? If you are a Christian, you know, the devil has ways and means. He's still the same today as he was then. He still has his tactics, you know. And then he quoted scripture. Like I can quote today to you. These signs shall follow them that believe. Well, if you haven't got the signs and you die of cancer or something, you can't be a Christian. You know, that's devil speaking. There's no God speaking. There's the same old devil the same way. I'm not denying the word. I'm not saying these signs don't follow them that believe. Them, you know, that it's not just me. It's them, the church of God. But you see, the same devil has the same method. And here, the devil even quotes the word of God. Have you ever had people quoting words to you? Here, look at here. But then, if people quote a scripture to you and you feel uneasy about it, always ask, what is the next verse saying? that often explains it. But you see, he tried so hard quoting the word, and Jesus answered him, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. It's tempting. I've heard from people say, why don't you go to a graveyard and raise all the dead? I have seen a man raised from the dead. But doesn't mean we can go down to the graveyard and they will rise if they're in Christ. Amen. So, in his time. And again the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them, and saith unto him, all these things will I give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. What a demand, I give you all this. I give you all this if you worship me. And then Jesus said to him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. You see, it was quite tricky after 40 days and nights not having eaten, and you feel hungry, and then somebody comes and says, look, if you are who you say you are, then turn this stone into bread. And then quoting the word, and then asking for worship and offering the whole world. Jesus knew that he would inherit the whole world, but he had to go to Calvary so he could have us with him there. Otherwise, we wouldn't go there. So he would not accept that nonsense. And then after Jesus overcame the devil, it says, then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. Have you ever had that? When you overcame a trial that you felt so good that the angels came and ministered to you? It's a wonderful thing. But I'd like to read you now Acts chapter 20, verse 27. As the Apostle Paul said, for I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Amen. So all the counsel of God. So we must not only preach the whole counsel of God, but we also must receive it. See, that's one thing, is preaching it, hearing it. The other one is receiving it. About 3-4 weeks ago, I had this quite impressive dream. I was standing next to a pulpit just like this, and I was preaching my heart out and telling people, you have to receive him. You have to be born again. And here was a jug of water and an empty glass. And I said, it's nothing wrong what's in the jug. It's all here. It's all written here. All the blessings, all the benefits, all the revelations, all the mysteries, everything is in here. It's in the jug. But you've got to have it in your vessel. You have to pour it in. So what I'm saying, preaching the whole counsel of God is one thing. It's my responsibility this morning. I mean, I can't elaborate on everything, but I make the point this morning. But it's for you to receive it. I can't do that. So all the preaching is no good if we haven't got anybody who receives it. All the promises of God, what are they good for if nobody can receive them and manifest them? I've seen the promises of God in my own life so many, many, many times. Supernatural things happened because I believed this is God. And he said it. I don't understand why it doesn't happen now. He didn't say when, but we have to believe what he says. So, okay, Brother Howard was saying he doesn't want to labor on churches, neither do I, what other churches do. But I have to say, some churches or people, I'd like you to draw a parallel. You know, when you talk about a denomination, is when people form around a certain doctrine or idea, a certain way of doing things, they form a denomination. They feel quite comfortable. But you can form the same kind of denomination on your own. Or your family. My family does things like this. And then I think if everybody else doesn't do the same thing, they might be wrong. No, it's not. We don't want to have that. So I want to say some churches look at the overall picture. Some churches just preach their doctrines which fit into their denomination. We say and quote and believe what we feel comfortable with. I always feel comfortable with talking about Calvary and the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses us from all sin. I always feel comfortable with that. But there's still more in the word as well. No challenge, no other things, not the whole truth. So you start to feel comfortable. You go to church, you don't have to sit at the edge of your seat, you just sit there comfortably. You know what's coming. I went to a church like that when I first came to the Lord. It was, even if somebody prayed, they all prayed the same kind of prayer. They went through a certain ritual which the founder had a revelation, and then it became a ritual. Thank you, Lord, that you make me righteous. Thank you, Lord, that you cleanse me and make me holy. Thank you, Lord. And it was all good. But it became almost a church ritual. It's not wrong to pray that. But when somebody else comes and prays differently, oh, what's wrong with him? Yes, you see, that's the problem. We need to be open to the whole truth of God. So if truth does not fit into the church ideology, when it is not preached or even, you know, then it's not preached if it doesn't fit in. Could you imagine going to a Baptist church and they preach baptism in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ? Or can you imagine going to a Baptist church and say, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? That's in the scripture, book of Acts. Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Well, I went to the altar and I was baptized in the church. And they said, you believe and that's it. You've got the Holy Ghost. No, you're a Baptist then. The Holy Ghost makes you a child of God. It doesn't matter what church you go to. You can receive the Holy Ghost in the Catholic Church. Probably wouldn't stay there for good, but you know, God's word is not bound, I tell you that much. So we can end up preaching either our experience or non-experience. Our experience or non-experience. You know, the Bible says you must be born again. We all know that. And we've heard it before. But be honest, there are so many interpretations you hear what it means to be born again. Some insist you have to have a certain experience, a certain thing has to happen. Others say you just accept the word. The way we present it to you, of course, you accept the word. That means you've got the Holy Ghost. You agree with every word of God? Yes. Have you ever read it? No. But you see, it's just that way. Others say, speak in tongues. Now, you've got the Holy Ghost. That's true. You've got a Pentecostal church, speak in tongues. Somebody was just telling me the other day, he lists a man... Oh, he's got his television shows or something. He was teaching people to speak in tongues. say gobbledygook and say whatever, you know, and keep on saying, now you speak in tongues. There's no evidence of the Holy Ghost. Anybody can do that. But you see, I come to the point. There are people that make that the evidence, all right? Sure, there is an evidence. A day of Pentecost, they spoke in tongues, didn't they? Cornelius and his household, they started speaking in tongues when they heard the gospel preached. There's nothing wrong with that. It's praise God. And you know, but if a person has never spoken in tongues or with tongues, they always preach, it's not the evidence, it's not the evidence. That's all you hear. They don't preach, Cornelius spoke in tongues or this spoke in tongues. No, now they do the quote what Brother Branham said about, he said, if you stay long enough in the presence of God, you will speak with tongues. Honestly, I had that experience when I was a young Christian. I went to a church, you weren't even allowed to raise the hands. If one says, praise the Lord, you know, some deacon will come and say, quiet, we don't do that here. True. Speaking in tongues, keep away from that stuff, you know. That was never preached, except in a negative way. You know, I was at home, and I had somebody from church. I tell you the whole story. It's actually very interesting. It was quite a smallish fellowship in another town, and the church had me there, midweek meetings, and they sort of probably had plans for me. But then another group that sort of split up from that church heard about a young convert. So they were attracted and came along, and they brought a young man with them with the job to persuade me to come to their church. And when I was there, I seen the commotion and people upset, and you know, they were all worried. I have nothing to worry. I walk with the Lord. I'm not walking with this church or that church. I walk with the Lord. So you know what I did with this young man? I said, why don't you come to my house for a coffee after church? You know, oh yes. And people were upset because I took it with me. So I gave him a coffee and I gave him a cake to eat. And I felt the Holy Spirit moving. And I said, you know, is it better to get the lost sheep in before we try to put the sheep from one stable to another? You know, he threw up the coffee and the cake and everything was all over the place. He was so excited. He did not want to do that job. But what happened after he left, I was so happy because I felt I was doing the work of the Lord. I went to bed. I went on my knees and praising the Lord, thanking the Lord. And I was lying down. I just couldn't sleep. I kept on going back on my knees, praising God. And after about third, fourth time doing that, suddenly I spoke with tongues. I didn't know, you know, I didn't know exactly. I thought that's what it was. I could think differently. It was besides me. I was just, this whole body was going, speaking in tongues, worshiping God. And I was in a church who would never preach that. And then, guess what? I met this man, he's from a Pentecostal church. And I told him what happened. He said, brother, now you've got the Holy Ghost. I said, no, I got the Holy Ghost in the car when the Lord came down when I was on the way home from a church. You know, but you see, that's what people preach according to their experience. I don't think we need to, or non-experience. If you never experienced speaking in tongues, don't speak against it. Say, Lord, is there more for me? Don't want to force the issue, but, you know, your word says, pray for the gifts. Paul said, I wish you would speak with tongues. I mean, I'm not promoting things this morning. I'm just saying the whole counsel of God. You know, the church I went to, we were not allowed to raise the hands. And I read in the Bible, it says, I want that meant lift up holy hands. I read it in the Bible, and I told my friend, I said, look, the Bible says lift up holy hands. You know, it was all new. I said, let's go in the forest. We did. I said, you go behind that tree, I go behind that tree, and you pray, I pray, and when you pray, lift your hands towards the Lord. You know, it was so new, because it wasn't preached. He went behind the tree, I'm behind the tree. We came back together, and he said, hey, when I lifted my hands, I felt the presence of God, you know. you know what I'm trying to get across? The whole counsel of God is it's not just go, you know, like you have in these modern churches with light shows and steam coming up the ground and lights flashing and everybody, and here is a pop group on the top. You know, you could never say, oh, differentiate from a worldly woman and a godly woman, you know, and some of them quite indecent. She's playing and, you know, and then all the lights and everybody hands up, hands up. I don't think that's right either. I hope you get what I'm saying. So to be born again, there is so many interpretations to it too. But it's too important to take man's word. You know, it's the Spirit of God gives witness to your spirit that you're a child of God. That is what you need. The witness from God, not the witness from man. It's his witness that you are his child. And then you have nobody can talk you out of it. And you know, sometimes it takes a long time till you actually know you're a child of God. But you've always been a child of God. I had that experience last year. As I said early on, I did a DNA test, you know. And then suddenly I come across a match with a cousin. Did not know that person. And I met her last year overseas. Her mother died when she was 3 months old, so she never knew her mother. And nobody knew her father. Nobody knew who her father was. So she was adopted. And her father was my uncle. So her and I shared the same grandfather. So she was family. And I could show her a picture. I could tell her what her real name was, and she was so excited that suddenly she had an identity. But she was that before she ever found out. She was about 63 until she found out who she belonged to. And you know, sometimes we can sit in church for all these years and we still don't know who we really are. Well, you're either a son of God or a daughter of God, or you're not. And if you believe in the Lord, who drew you? You know, who did that? You know, in Romans it says, them he foreknew. The Lord foreknew. He said, them he also called. And you know, something spoke to me. Yes, he called me. And he predestinated them. And he justified them in Christ. So once it sinks in, it's the word that quickens to you. Say, wow, then, what is this? His? Oh, it's been. And, you know, it changes your entire being. It changes. So take what God says about you, not what people say about you. You know, my experience was maybe not the way some others have it, but I lived a pretty wild life when I was young. And not a good life, but then the Lord started to draw me. And it started, can't go that far back, Labor Weekend, 1978. Just before that, I sort of started to think, what's life all about? What do you do? And I was on the motorbike traveling around, ended up in Tauranga one night, going from one pub to the other. And when I was drunk enough, I came out to the pub and I saw 2-3 people outside, one with a guitar, doing what Brother Howard was preaching this morning, reaching out to people. And he was a Maori boy with a guitar. I went to him, as I said, when I had enough to drink, saw him a few times before, patted him on his back and said, "You do a good job, bro. Convert those heathens out here," I said to him. "I believe in God." You know, wow, big deal. The devil believes in God as well and trembles, the Bible said. But that's what I said to him. In my ignorance, in my own denomination, to go to church, they're all hypocrites anyway out there. True, there are lots of hypocrites out there, but it doesn't stop me from having church. And you know, he didn't say, "Oh, you're confused, you know, go away." No, he said, "May I pray for you?" Well, that flattened me. I thought, pray for me? A person wants to pray for me? Never heard of such a thing. I thought, if you pray, you pray, "Lord, give me this, help me there, do this, do that." Pray for somebody else never crossed my mind. Never. And he prayed, and you know what? I sobered up. Inwardly, completely, instantly, despite all the booze I had, I was sober. Instead of going to a party, I went to a hotel and stayed overnight. And the first time in years, I cried. But I was still not knowing where to go. But God started a work. And just to say, I don't finish there. The next day, it was Labor Weekend, I was in Rotorua. And of course, all the motels were booked out. No place to go. So I was, something else happened too that night when that man prayed for me. He talked about Jesus Christ. And he prayed to Jesus. And I thought, wow, Bible says you should have no other God besides God. So you don't actually pray to Jesus, or you don't pray to the Holy Ghost, or you only pray to the Father. In the name of Jesus. You know, I had that much in my understanding. But then I thought, I was in Rotorua, I was in a pub, but I didn't want to get drunk. I had one drink and I thought, well, Jesus Christ must be God, otherwise I cannot approach him. I said, "Jesus, if you're real, if you're God, you know I need a place tonight. Please give me a place." I didn't even speak it out loud. I looked up and conveyed that to him. You know, I went out of that pub. I went to, it was already 9 o'clock at night, to the next motel next door. And guess what? No, they didn't have room. they said, "I'm sorry, it's whole Rotorua is booked out." You know, they have a list from other motels. It's all booked out. I said, "Well, is there a railway station or something, somewhere where I can, you know, get shelter?" It was raining as well. And they said, "No, don't know anything." And then as I walked out, they called me back and said, "Hey, I just wait." And they had some folder. They said, "Look, some people we know, they sometimes have students or things like that. So we could always try to ring them." So they rang up. And there was in Nongada. So I went there and they welcomed me about 10 o'clock at night. And guess what? They were Christians. And the next day they gave me a Bible. And then I started to read the Bible when I was back down in New Plymouth. And guess what? It was not what I thought I was. I was what the Bible said I was. And at that state, when I was in that state, it taught me that I was a sinner. It showed me a scripture about, I had a friend, I showed him the big wild world because he was a bit backward, I thought. So I had to introduce him to the big things in the world. But then I read the scripture. If you offend one of those little ones, better have a millstone tied around your neck and be drowned in the sea. I thought, oh, I failed. That's me. I showed him all the bad things. You know, I had to repent. So I bought him a Bible for his birthday. And I wrote, I never forget, I wrote in the first page, I said, may this book of truth help you through life to find life. And he thought, what's wrong with him? You know, he sort of threw it in a cupboard. But that was the Lord speaking to me by his word. And another one was, I read, the drunkards won't be ready at the coming of the Lord. And I can honestly say I was drunk every night. Drunk. Not just having a drink, drunk. So I tried not to drink so much. Only till I was half drunk. You know, all these things started to move in my life. Until about a year later when I was overseas, I was talking to an evangelist, and I was just spoken to by the Lord so much. He showed me some scriptures. He said, have you ever stolen? You know, I said, stolen? That's the least I've done. That's nothing, you know. He wanted to know if I'm aware that I was a sinner. But we came to the Bible, scripture in Acts, where it says, and they were sanctified by faith in Jesus Christ. And he said, do you understand what that means? I said, yeah, these people here in the Bible, you know, they were made saints. They were holy because they believed in Jesus Christ. And then he says, do you believe in Jesus Christ? I said, yeah. I mean, I'm trying so hard to live right. He said, what does it mean to you? Oh, no, I can't say I'm holy. You know, no way I'm holy, you know. No way. And then I had like a film going down in front of me, my life. You hypocrite. Of course you're not holy. You know, the devil is right there when you want to make business with God. The devil stands right next to you as well. But then, praise God, I thought, that is the truth. The Bible is the truth. Then I say what the Bible says, and I said, then I'm holy. And I thought he might hit me, or he might tell me off. He said, no. Have you ever thanked him for it? I said, no. So we went on our knees, and I thanked the Lord for what he's done in Christ. I went home, driving the car. About 20 minutes later, it just came down from heaven. I can't explain it. I screamed, I cried. I just couldn't help praising God. And you know, me, holy saint, you know, I went home, I poured out all my whiskeys and rums and whatever I had and put it all down the sink, you know. It was different. And then people thought I've gone nuts. My parents didn't like the new me anymore, and my old friends didn't want to know me, and I was just different. I was delivered. I was free. The truth shall set you free. And you know, there was a time when I had to accept, yes, I'm a sinner, but there's also a time when you repent that you accept. Now you're a saint. You can't be a sinner saint. You are one or the other. Praise the Lord. Let's not take man's word. Let's take God's word.
Amen.
So I never spoke in tongues then. That came about 3 months later. So I'm just saying. So what does the Bible say? You must be born again, we said. And as I said, here come so many interpretations. Depending on someone's experience, sometimes, or non-experience, that's what you say. I say to somebody, how were you born again? When did you have that experience? Oh, you know. And then if you say it long enough, then they try to figure out that may have been then or that may have been then. Why not seek it? I want to be sure about my eternal destiny. I don't want to just take man's word or my own little teaching or a church teaching. You know, you can go to a Catholic church and be baptized there, and then you have a ticket to heaven. That's what they tell you. But it doesn't change your life. Now, you know, I said, be certain that you receive the whole counsel of God. And the best is, read it for yourself. Now, seek him with all your heart, the Bible says. It's too important to take man's word for it. Or don't let a speck of pride hinder you from receiving it. That often happens too. Now, this man I was telling you who showed me these scriptures at the time, he was running a youth camp. And then there was two young girls. They were daughters of a preacher that were there. And, you know, they were quite active and singing and playing the guitar. But this man, this evangelist, had a lot of discernment. And he went to the father, he was a pastor. He said, "Brother, I just want to say, your daughters are not born again. They need an experience in Christ." You know what happened? The pastor was offended. Offended. "Who do you say this? And my daughters don't need that, and they're fine the way they are." I don't know where they are now, but you see, let's not be offended by the truth. This man had discernment. Absolutely. So our destination for eternity hinges on that. So we don't want man's word or a word from this church or that church. We want the whole counsel of God, and we want to be sure we receive it from him. So as I said before, the evidence of having the Holy Ghost, then most churches agree we need to have the Holy Ghost. But then it varies from church to church, from person to person, depending on their teaching, experience, or non-experience. People make verbal confessions or be baptized or speaking in tongues or believing a certain preacher or keeping the Sabbath or whatever it is. They make that their evidence of having the Holy Ghost. You know, you go to one church, you say, "Keeping the Sabbath, that's a seal of God." All right. I found the true Sabbath in Christ. But you see, that's when you're taught that way, you start to think that way. But then you go to another one, and they say it's, like I said, speaking in tongues. No, you've got the event. No, you've got the Holy Ghost. So you go to a Pentecostal church, and you speak in tongues, or they teach you how to speak with tongues. Then you take that as the evidence. Or then you go to another one. I've been to a Brethren church. Lovely, very nice. Very fundamental, good teaching, I have to say, and beautiful people. We had one meeting, Bible study in somebody's home. I went along, and then I was able to share one or two things, and then the Holy Ghost started to move. They started to look at each other, didn't know what was happening. They did not know what it was. It was a Holy Ghost, because it's so set in their minds and in their ways. The next day I saw one of them. He came, grabbed me with both hands. Wasn't it a wonderful meeting last night? You know, but it's as far as it went. Because of the teaching, you don't go out from that. I was wanting to hire Nongan Tau they have a buildings there where you can have a camp or something. It's mostly empty. So I asked if I can hire it for a weekend. I got the forms to fill in, and I had to promise that nobody would speak in tongues. Honestly. I said, look, normally in our church, nobody has the gift of interpretation, so nobody speaks in tongues. Maybe in quiet prayer or something, but nobody does. But I can't sign a paper that couldn't happen or wouldn't happen. So I thought, man, where are we at? Let's have the whole counsel of God. Amen. Well, God says everything. We all need an absolute regarding our experience of being born again. We need it personally. You don't need my interpretation or exactly my experience or Brother Howard's experience or somebody else's. You need your own experience with the Lord and be certain yourself that he, because, you know, we are all uniquely made. We don't all come exactly the same way. You know, to some, to quit this doesn't mean a thing. To others, it means everything. You know, he knows where to put the finger. And he knows where you need to die to self. It's we're all different. We have different ways, which are too much alive sometimes. So experience with vindication, a changed life that conforms to the word of God. I like that, you know, if the spirit that wrote this word, we believe it's inspired by the Holy Ghost, is in you, you would have to say yes or amen to every word of God. But even the pages that haven't been taught to you, you come across it, you have to say yes. So a new, you know, a new birth is something you do. Any birth you remember. A birth is a birth. It's a mess. I mean, I remember the day, the night, what happened. But the Apostle Paul, I just want to make this example quickly. Don't want to take too much time. He was on the way to Damascus to go and take prisoners, Christians, this heresy bunch, you know. He was taught in the scripture, in the Old Testament. He was zealous and vigilant and whatever the words are. And he had no idea of Jesus Christ. He would read Isaiah. He was wounded for our transgressions and he was bruised for our iniquity. Oh, that is something somewhere else. That's the Messiah when he comes, or that's this or that's that. But never thought of Jesus Christ. But then the Lord himself spoke to him. A light threw him off the horse, off the high horse. He was on the ground. And he said, Lord, who art thou? And he said, I'm Jesus whom thou persecutest. Well, he didn't persecute Jesus. Yes, he did. In the believers, which saying, I'm the temple of the Holy Ghost. If you persecute your brother, you persecute Jesus. That's really what it is. So here he is, and he refers back to that experience many times when he preaches. And he preaches the resurrection from the dead from then on. Not many people liked it. They listened to him. He is interesting to listen to. He has a lot of good stories. But then when he talked about the resurrection of the dead, you know, they didn't want it. But he came back to that experience, and to him, that changed everything. He said, what I know, my knowledge, my own doing, was like dung, he said, compared with the glory of the cross of Jesus Christ. So that's Apostle Paul, had that experience. You don't have to hire a horse and drive to Damascus to get that experience. As I said, I had it in the car. You can be in your bedroom praying. It can be anywhere. But if you mean business with God, he means business with you. Now, signs and wonders follow them that believe, the Bible says. Them that believe. I've got a daughter, and she said once to me, Dad, I've seen more miracles in my life than it's written in the book of Isaiah, what prophet Isaiah had. And I can testify of the same. I've seen more miracles in my life as I read in some of the days of the prophets. He is doing things. You know, 2.5 years ago, I was a cripple. I had a back injury, a back problem. I was in such agony, I couldn't move. And I went to a physio, and the messed it up even more. Then I was paralyzed and I couldn't lift my foot anymore. I was dragging my foot along. I walked around like that for about 2 months. And then they actually got me to an emergency specialist and all these things and had the scans and all that. And they said, oh, the doctor said, look, I haven't seen it that bad before. My discs were all out and everything, the nerve damaged. Anyway, I prayed and I prayed and I thought, Lord, why am I not healed? You know, these signs follow them that believe. Lay hands on the sick, you know. I think I even laid hands on myself, you know, and nothing happened. He didn't say when. You know, he didn't say when. I said, Lord, if that's your way, I'm willing to go the way. I didn't want to disbelieve, but I said, speak through the doctor, I said. So at the day of the operation, he said, you have to do something straight away, otherwise never have a chance to walk again properly. Anyway, I was at the operating table. A anaesthetist pulls his mask down, tells me what he's going to do, and then the doctor pats me on the shoulder and said, how are you feeling? Just before they put you out, tried to encourage you a bit. I said, oh, quite good. He said, oh. Then he touched my knee and said, have you got feelings there? I said, yeah. And then he said, oh, can you walk? And I had to get off the bed, wearing this nightie, you know, and I had to walk, and I walked and dragged my foot along because I couldn't lift it. And then he comes, he looks at me, didn't speak for about half a minute, and suddenly he said, if I were you, I'll cancel the operation. Didn't need to hear that twice, I tell you. Praise God! I rejoiced, but I was still crippled, but I rejoiced like I'm totally healed. You know, I rang my wife, she burst into tears, you know, and she picked me up. 3 days later, I wake up in the morning completely healed. And a week later, I played a tennis tournament. That's how healed I was. M. But I'm saying, these signs felt, you know, I know genuine brothers and sisters in Christ, you know, they have died of a disease. Doesn't mean they're unbelievers. You know, that doesn't mean that. I don't say that. But let's never doubt what the word says. Some people can't raise the faith for certain things. Doesn't mean they're not believers. But if you can raise the faith, you can see miracles, even today. I've seen a man healed of cancer instantly. He had 2 weeks to live by the doctor. And he said, I don't think I make it 2 weeks. He looked terrible. He was just a skeleton. And in agony and pain as can be. And cut a long story short, I told him exactly what the scripture says. He wasn't a churchgoer. And I said, look, I can pray for you, but you have to have faith. He said, oh, I have faith. Well, I asked the Lord to forgive me sins. And then I asked, told the devil to leave him and laid my hands on him. I said, amen. I didn't feel anything. Didn't expect anything. That's how little my faith was, really. But I did what the word said, you know. That's the main one. You do what the word says, not how you feel. You do what it says. And you know what happened? I would say less than half a minute, he said, oh, pains are going away. I said, that's a great sign, you know, hang on to that, you know. You know, he was completely healed instantly. He died 5 years later at the age of 90 of old age. You know, that is a miracle. And I've seen it. And I've been there. But I'm not a miracle healer or anything. But I just did what the word said. And he believed it and accepted it. And it was done. You know, we need to have some vindication. You know, we can't just live. You know, as good as sound may sound, but we have a church down the road and they have this great big sign out every week, something else, some phrase or some funny thing. And a while ago, it was all in Arab, you know, after they shot those Muslims in Christchurch, they had it all in Arab, you know, we are one or whatever. I don't know what it meant, you know, I can't read the Arab language. And one day I was driving past, he said, learn to live with arthritis. That was on there. Seminar, you know, how you can cope with it and how, you know, and how to support each other and all that stuff. But I thought, that's like, learn to live with the devil. Yeah. Don't learn to live with the devil. Realize these things are demons. And they're not part of the temple of the Holy Ghost. And let Jesus in, cast that rubbish out. All the unbelief and all that nonsense. Then you don't have to live with these things. I just watched, it was on YouTube, some old 1950s or 60s meetings. There was this preacher. He preached, prayed for this woman, arthritis. She just staggered up. Next thing, she was dancing around and jumping around. Yeah, you know. But it's casting out the demon. You know, people say, look, if you're a doctor or a nurse, you think, you know, that's actually... The bones are this way or this is that way and that is a growth and sure. What does it? The wrong spirit causes the body to go wrong. So it's actually not, you look at the, it's not the evidence. You see the outworking of the demon. We had a young girl, she's only 19. She nearly died, and she was in hospital about 2 months ago, and she had a seizure, you know, jumping around and losing every facility and biting herself and bleeding, and they took her to the hospital, and in the ambulance, she had another seizure. You know, people say, oh, that's normal, that's natural, it's because of high blood pressure and this and that, and then, you know, that happens, and then what causes all these things? It's still a demon that does it. So she's fine now. But you see, we have to, not to learn to live with these things, neither do we want to be satisfied with just that much of the word. We want all of the word of God. Just imagine you a woman marries a husband. She wants all of him. All his love. Not just the money or the security or the house. She wants the attention, everything of him. We want everything from the Lord. And he wants everything of us. So just in closing, Romans 8:14 says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God.
Thank you, Lord.
And also daughters of God. So how can you be led by the Spirit if you allow him to lead you? That's all you have to do. Lord, you show me. Oh, no, that's not convenient. Well, I showed you, but you still decide. It's not those who hear of the Spirit, those who are led by the Spirit. So I find that's quite interesting. And you know what? One other thing is another evidence. You know what the Holy Spirit in you does? It always will glorify Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Spirit of truth cometh, he will glorify me, Jesus said. Just, it's a good one to discern. So John 6:44. No man can come to me except the Father which has sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day. That's all there is to it. If God draws you, you just have to receive what he brings across your way. That's all. I finish here with Jeremiah 29:13. It says, and ye shall seek me and find me when ye shall search for me with all your heart. So my advice or encouragement is, let's draw towards him. Let's draw nigh to him. He will draw nigh to us. we heard this morning, to resist the devil, resist the things and draw nigh to God. We live in such an time where everything's offered to you. And it gives you a false security. It gives you a false quenching of your thirst. It's not the real quenching of the thirst. It has become acceptable in this world. What would have shocked people a generation before or two, it's become acceptable. We see it all around. And in a time like this, we need to resist that. I don't know about you, but I sometimes read newspapers on the computer. You know, you can switch the computer on and you want to read a newspaper, but you get all the garbage any tabloid had about 20, 30 years ago, all the rubbish, but you don't have to read it. I don't need to know what even the names, Prince Harry does, or this movie star or that one. Why wouldn't we need to know what filth they're up to? That's how you actually resist that stuff. Don't even look at it, read it, don't fill your mind with that rubbish. Switch it off, read your news. But then again, it's a lot of lies in those papers too. You read one newspaper, they're all against this person, and everything he does is wrong and everything like that. And you read another one, oh, it's all good and it's all good. Who do you take? What counsel do you take? Take it from the left or from the right or from the center or from the liberals or from whatever political persuasion they have, where do you take it from? Goes the same with here. You get people on that side, oh, we are inclusive, you know, we have, our pastor is a homosexual, oh, we love everybody, Jesus loves everybody, you know. You get that kind, and then you get the others, you know. I had one, look, I'll finish with this. Brother Howard was saying, I've got a church and the church office opening up straight into the street. So I have my church office door open, and I'm there quite often. People walk past and sometimes come in. And about 2 weeks ago, I had this woman coming. I said, oh, what's that? Is that church or is that knives? Or, you know, because I put the knife sharpening sign up just to get a few more contacts. I'm not interested in knife sharpening, really. But I said, both. Here you can have whatever you want. Church or knife sharpening. And then she came in and then she started telling me her life story and how she trusted the Lord everywhere. And incredible things happened to her, and she just still trusts the Lord. She said, look, I have to move out my place next Wednesday and have no place to go. Oh, you'll see me back here to testify what the Lord has provided for me. You know, a real person who looks to the Lord. And then she said about church, and I said, oh, it's here. And behind my office, I've got the door open up and straight into the church. Oh, I didn't know that was there. And then she saw the pulpit. Now she says to me, I'm saying that not to preach doctrine, not to, I'm just saying what happened. So about taking the whole counsel of God. She sees the pulpit in the front of the church. And she said, do you know what? If I go to a church and I see a woman behind the pulpit, I walk straight out. She said, straight out. Well, good. She said, the Bible says a woman should not preach and have authority over men. So I would walk straight out. And then I thought, well, what about, I didn't say anything, but what about turn the page and read the scripture where Paul says, doesn't even common sense tell you a woman should have long hair and a man should have short hair? She had very short hair. I'm not saying that to condemn one or the other. I just say she took one so strongly that she would, you know, despise that woman who doesn't know any better maybe or whatever, and walk straight out of church. but she can't see the page next to it. And a lot of people and churches, they don't even know it's in the Bible because it's not preached. Doesn't mean it's not part of the Word of God. I'm saying the whole counsel of God, no matter where you go to church, read your Bible and pray. And you find things you haven't heard before. Let's just pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you this afternoon for reflecting on the Word of God and how mighty you are and how you never changed. And Lord, we do need the whole counsel of God. And Lord, I do pray for each one of us here and who hear this, have heard this little message. I just pray that you will grant us the spirit of wisdom and of revelation. Lord, that we can be convinced in our own selves that we are serving you and that we have heard from you and that we walk in the truth. I just pray that your Holy Spirit would continue to lead, draw us and guide us in the name of Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, I pray if any one of us has grieved your spirit in any way, I pray for forgiveness. Lord, for whatever has caused it, I pray that you will forgive us. I commit these matters under the blood of Christ and pray grant us a sensitive heart to see and hear what the Spirit saith to ourselves in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. It's so simple, really. So simple. You know, the moment you embrace the truth, then everybody else is no good. You go blind the same day as you do that. I've seen it so many times. People think they have something and they insist and they don't realize that they even hate the brother because they don't agree with them, or that's not scriptural. Praise the Lord. Amen. Are we willing to accept the whole counsel of God? You know, he may show you something during the week. You have not come across a new challenge or something. Go and visit the sister there. Oh, I don't really get on with her. Bible says visit orphans and widows. She's a widow. Yeah, good enough. Go and visit her. You know, we need to embrace the whole truth. We need to go with what the Bible says. Like I said at the beginning, the devil uses every trick in the box to deceive you, trying to mislead you. So we need every word of God to stand against it. I want to be able to say, it is written, and I want to have it in my heart. I don't have to learn it. I want it in my heart so I can stand against the wiles and attacks of the enemy. It is written. And if you ever have, look, I said that the other Sunday, I said, look, if you ever have a struggle or something, ring me any day or night time. You know, if my phone rings, I mean, it's ringing at 3 a.m. Oh, brother, can you come along? We have a drama at home. So what? Let's go home. Oh, I need to sleep. Yeah, well, then next day you may be tired or maybe not. But it doesn't matter. They're important things. Last Monday night, I had a call after I sat there on Sunday, late at night. Say, oh, I know I'm not in the right place. I'm trying to witness to this person. I don't know what to say because I'm not in the right place myself. What can I do? And yeah, you know, it's good to fellowship, to be honest with one another. If you haven't got it, somebody else may have it, and encourages you to receive it as well. God bless you all. Should we sing a song? What a day that will be. Amen. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, when I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see.
Close in prayer with a word of prayer, and then we'll sing that as we go. Precious Lord Jesus, Lord, we just come before you, Lord, in the closing, Lord, and we just thank you for, Lord, this word this afternoon, Lord, that we can take all of your counsel, Lord, and Lord, we believe it, Lord. We take all of your word, Lord, that we might walk, Lord, in the paths of truth, Lord Jesus, and that you would guide us. Lord, I just pray a blessing upon each one as we go our way, Lord, and a special blessing upon Brother Albert, Lord. Keep him safe as he travels home, Lord, and Sister Roberta as well, Lord. Go up the coast as well, Lord, and we just commit all things into your hands as we go our way in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Let's just sing that as we go.
What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be.
Amen. God bless you, saints. You are dismissed in the name of the Lord.